My name is Leonard C. Johnson. I've been a resident of Jamestown for a good many years, with the exception of living 15 years in Warren, Pennsylvania, and of course 3 years in World War II. How I happened to be at Chautauqua that day was the fact that I was a Boy Scout and Troop 5 from the First Baptist Church on 5th Street. And although I didn't belong to that church, but they had a good scout troop there, so I belonged there. We had a good recreation program and everything. Just a handful of us were taken up to Chautauqua that day. And our job was to take people from the main entrance to Chautauqua down to the amphitheater, which we did a few times. And then I happened to remember that I went over to looking at the amphitheater stage. I went over to the right side of the property. And this is where Roosevelt came in the sedan. And as he got out of the car, and of course he had braces, lock braces, and went from there into the amphitheater.
So what was the path again? I'm trying to visualize it. So the amphitheater, I'm looking at the front of the amphitheater.
Mm-hmm.
How would he come in?
Well, as you're looking at the stage, it's the right side.
Okay.
Over to the right.
Right.
And
the car would come up, and then there was...
It pulled in, and of course, the thing that always stood out in my mind, and I told a number of people, was the fact that the state police, they, to me, looked like 8 or 9 foot tall, big men. And of course, their job was to make security there and to keep us people back, which they did, you know. And the next thing, of course, he started to make a speech. Roosevelt started to make a speech. And as I remember, as he was going in to the amphitheater, they had this handkerchief waving, all white, and looked like thousands to me, but I don't know just how many there were, 4,000 or 5,000 or whatever they held it, but it was to a packed house anyway. And then he went on to make a speech, and then after that, I can't remember anything at all that really stands out, unless you have a question for
sure.
Me.
I do. How old were you?
14.
14. And so your Boy Scout troop was selected. Were there a lot of other Boy Scout troops that have been?
No. There was just a handful of us that I remember out of Troop 5, First Baptist Church.
And you had your uniform on?
Oh, yes.
And your role was literally to walk, escort people down?
Down to the path, down to the amphitheater, because, well, people were coming from all over back then.
And when did you, when was the speech? Was it an evening speech?
No, it was in the afternoon.
Afternoon, was it?
Yeah,
okay.
It was in the afternoon. The time value, I couldn't tell you the time value. No, it was daytime. I don't know what the time was, but it was at daytime.
Did you happen to be up there at the gate when the car came through? Do you remember that?
No, I was not at the main gate. No, I was down at the amphitheater, and I went over to that area. I think somebody had said something to me about he was going to come into that area in a sedan and with an escort, and so I walked over in that area when the sedan pulled in.
Describe the car. Do you remember?
No, big sedan.
Do you know who was in the car with the president?
Excuse me. No, I don't. All I remember seeing is Roosevelt, President Roosevelt.
What was your feeling when you saw him?
Well, being 14 years of age, I'd feel much greater about it than I did then, you know. But it was still history.
comes President Roosevelt's declaration on foreign policy, which he made not as a political candidate, but as a spokesman for the American people.
I have seen war on land and sea. I have seen blood running from the wounded. I have seen children starving. I have seen the agony of mothers and wives. I hate war.
Did you know that he was disabled?
Yes. Yes. And of course, eventually, I was in the orthopedic field myself, making braces and artificial limbs. And so I knew the type of braces he was wearing, you know, lock braces and that, from having polio.
When he walked out or got out, was there people helping him out, do you remember, or did he sort of slide out?
He slid out himself, yes.
He stood up.
But there was always somebody right there that wanted to help.
Right.
But he went by himself into the amphitheater.
So when you talk about ushering people down from the gate to their seats, basically, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not the main gate, but the gate by the gates by the amphitheater?
Well, they go in the main entrance from the, you go from in the back part of the amphitheater, you know,
right, right.
Where they do now.
Right, right.
You know, you give the tickets and so on and so forth. Yeah, but it was quite an experience, and of course I read the article in the paper, so I thought, well, I'll call over there to the Jackson Center and tell them my experiences, which a lot of years have gone by since then, so.
Yeah, 1936, and here we are, 2004, that's quite a few years. When you do the math, you're a very sharp guy.
Yes, I'm sort of surprised I've lived this long, but I'm 82 now, but still active. And that's one of the main things in life, I think, is to stay active.
During the ceremony, where did you sit?
I didn't sit.
Okay.
No, I didn't sit. I was always on my feet, you know,
okay.
And watching the flag waving and everything from that entrance area or the side of the area there where you could look in and see all. That was a great speech he made, and so I never believed in the rumors that Roosevelt knew about Pearl Harbor.
December 7th, 1941. Nipponese planes were swooping down on Pearl Harbor. Within hours, the United States declared war.
December 7th, 1941. A date which will live in infamy.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
Never could possibly believe that.
Right.
And of course, I went in the service November 1942. A friend of mine, Bill Miller, and I, we were going to go enlist in the service, but we were already drafted. So I was overseas 2.5 years.
Where did you go?
In Europe. And I was in England about a year, and then I went Utah beachhead, Normandy, late at night.
D-Day?
Yeah, late at night.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, on LST. But those were great experiences too. How I made it back, I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm still here.
Well, as you see, the remembrances of D-Day, yeah, the History Channel and stuff like that. What kind of emotions does that bring to you?
I wanted to go back over when Eisenhower was going to visit Omaha Beachhead post-war. And, of course, I could never get myself to do it. Mm-hmm. That fear of looking across this, so many thousands of young men dying, just got to me. And I think that if you talk to a few other veterans, they feel the same way, mm-hmm, too. Mm-hmm. It's quite a tragedy. And, of course, if there's any miracles in life, I'll say that one of the great miracles of the world was America. Back in those days, they went on and threw a war on two fronts, and we still won, which was almost impossible because Japan and Germany had years head start on us. So, tough times.
Sure.
The greatest generation, Tom Brokaw.
You no doubt lost some of your friends.
Out of our gang of, shall I say, gang of fellows, you know, that we used to play ball with and that, at that time we only lost one, and his name was Raymond Castle. Mm-hmm. He's in the soldier circle up to Lakeview Cemetery, and he went in on the invasion of southern France, and he wasn't in very long, and he was killed, the German mortar. But we missed him an awful lot, too, over the years. But all the fellows in our so-called gang, shall we say, that played ball together and hung around together, we come back, but we weren't the same people as when we left.
Utah Beach, and then where did you progress from there?
Well, up through Normandy. I can tell you another interesting story. The second day in Normandy. That's all hedgerow country.
Right.
And the first sergeant told us to take a break, and of course we were still soaking wet because when we come off the LST we went into water right up to here, chest high. But we were laying on the ground there in the cold and so on and so forth, and all of a sudden, the first sergeant told us we got to move out. So I happened to look over, and I see something laying there on the ground. And I reached over and picked it up, and there was no moon, so it was dark. So I brought it right up close to me like this, and I says, "I'll be darned." Soldier next to me says, "Why, what did you find?" I says, "It's a 4-inch crescent wrench from Jamestown, New York." He says, "So what?" I says, "Well, that's my hometown. That's where we make these wrenches." So that's a little unusual, and of course, I have that in my display case now. I kept it with me just as a memento, you know. So I thought that was pretty interesting, too. So I went up through Belgium, saw Patton's tanks standing there, out of gas.
Mm-hmm.
Saw Patton's movie yesterday for about the third time. Mm-hmm. Just a fantastic movie.
Right.
George C. Scott. But anyway, buzz bombs, Belgium. They were heavy traffic.
Right.
But I made it, and I'm back here.
Where were you on VE Day?
In France.
France.
Well, wait a minute. Was I? I was in France. I was back in France when Roosevelt died.
Mm-hmm.
The church bells at a near village was ringing the bells. And so when we finally got the message, they said Roosevelt had died.
Mm-hmm.
And this is 1945.
Right.
So, A lot of experiences. But I'm glad I'm still around to say something in reference to President Roosevelt and that famous speech there at Chautauqua. I think it was just a great speech.
This is terrific.
A lot of remembrance of back in those days, yes. A lot of history, a lot of memories. After all, what else do we take with us?
Exactly.
But memories.